We had some pilot data from a few years back showing that MS patients who smoked cannabis possibly had greater cognitive impairment than you'd anticipate. So there was this idea that lay dormant for a while and we wanted to go and explore it. Then it's also a field where there's not a whole lot of data. So these questions crop up all the time. You know, what effect might cannabis have on MS patients? Is it beneficial? Is it harmful? And we don't really know. So there was just the inquiry in that regard. And then I've always had a belief that cannabis from a behavioral point of view is actually quite harmful. The data from the general population show that it's linked to psychosis and mental health disturbance. And so there was a concern that this might be applicable to MS patients as well. And because MS forms a large part of my clinical practice, I wanted to investigate the problem. So we found that the MS patients that used cannabis as opposed to those who did not were more likely to have cognitive difficulties. Now, to give you a background sketch, MS by itself is associated with cognitive problems. So 40 to 60% of MS patients would have cognitive difficulties, even in the absence of cannabis. But what we found was that in the patients who smoked cannabis, the chances of developing cognitive difficulties went up. And these cognitive problems are really quite wide-ranging, including information processing speed impairments, executive function difficulties, visuospatial problems, and global cognitive impairment was also higher in this group as well. So executive functioning really refers to how you use your information in a practical way in terms of day-to-day living. And those were the areas where the impediments were most marked in terms of executive functioning, the speed at which you think, the speed with which you process information. That seemed to take a bigger hit in the patients using cannabis. The practical implications of that are as follows, that patients who are cognitively impaired have more trouble at work, they have greater difficulty in their day-to-day relationships, managing everyday activities, socializing, etc. So cognitive problems by themselves are not just some abstract finding, but they also are tightly correlated with some very real-world deficits as well, real-world problems, and it appears that cannabis could, in theory, make that worse. So I think, you know, we have to be careful how we interpret this study because the group of patients whom we studied were those who had used cannabis every day, usually every day, often for many years. So you have to bear it in mind that it's a very particular group of patients who we tested. Having said that, there are some patients who perhaps have more advanced multiple sclerosis who are not working, whose social tasks are not that onerous, who might derive some benefit from cannabis in terms of pain or spasticity. And I listen to patients when they tell me that. But for the younger patient who's working, who might be struggling cognitively, and is using cannabis on a regular basis, it would be a very firm recommendation from me that they stop using the cannabis. I see it as harmful in that subgroup of patients. So in terms of the future, where do we go with this? Well, I think it would be good if other study groups outside of Sunnybrook try to replicate these findings. Remember that our data are just based on 25 cannabis smokers and 25 non-cannabis smokers, so it's not a huge sample. Nevertheless, I think the cognitive data are quite robust. So we're moving on to another study, which is funded by the Multiple Sclerosis Society of Canada, looking at brain changes in MS patients who use cannabis and how these brain changes might relate to cognition. So we're going to be starting that study in the next couple months. And if indeed we can show that cannabis smokers have a different pattern of brain activation when it comes to dealing with cognitive tasks, then it really solidifies the data from this study and kind of firms up our conclusions. So I think brain imaging offers us that opportunity to do that. I think it's important to realize that our data is only applicable to patients who smoke cannabis, so the street cannabis. We didn't look at the synthetic cannabis or drugs like Sativex, which is the cannabis spray. Patients who were taking those medications were not part of the study. We confined our sample recruitment just to patients who were smoking cannabis. I think one patient ingested cannabis, but the majority smoked it. The research in the study was completed by one of my master's students, Kimia Onamand, and she did it as part of her master's program. and she was responsible for the data collection, much of the data analysis, and she did a very fine job with this.